Roger Corbett, welcome indeed. I guess it's an understatement of the day or of the year, very much to say that you've had a lot on your plate today. We all know just what you've been facing the last few hours, I guess. And so we very much are very grateful that you've managed to get here tonight. I thought I might start with one of the really easy questions of the day, which is, have you been trumped by John Fletcher? Are you going to get your hands on those liquor outlets?
Are you a journalist? first of all, I'd like to say it's a real privilege to be here. I've got to tell you, when I graduated from this place, I did so immensely proudly. I had wonderful years here. I enjoyed them immensely. We had great, great fun. And when I graduated, I never, ever thought I'd come back doing a job like that. And that's saying nothing about my past. If there's anyone from the press here, by the way, I'd like to just feel that I'm speaking off the record. And if you want to ask me a question more precisely for on the record, I'm happy to do that. But I'd really like to be free so I could chat and talk and not fear it's going to appear somewhere tomorrow and upset my breakfast. No, I don't think we've been trumped by John Fletcher. I've got to be really careful what I say here because I don't want to end up in jail or get sued or something like that. But I don't see this as a competition at all. I think it's very flattering that John Fletcher follows a lot of things we do. We expected John Fletcher to come in somewhere along the line. What remains is that these are a set of assets which are complementary to our business. We'll pay a price for it, and we'll pay no more. And the synergies and what we can get out of them, if it doesn't work, it doesn't work. So I don't see a competition at all. We're prepared to buy at a price. Our offer at the present time is $3.15. Looks a bit low compared to $3.35, but of course that's a scheme of arrangement. It's got to wait until January. So we'll just wait and see how it works its way out. But no, I don't think we've been trumped by John Fletcher.
One of a couple of the comments in the press this morning were that it's almost getting personal. So how do you answer that criticism or that comment?
No, I don't think it's personal. I have great respect for John Fletcher, but it's not John Fletcher and Roger Corbett. It's Woolworths and Coles Myer. You get portrayed as the person making all the decisions, but if you were sitting with me just about three quarters of an hour ago, you'd see you wouldn't make all the decisions at all. There's a board of directors that have a lot of insight, and there's a lot of people behind who are doing numbers and figures. And at the end of the day, it's simply, I think very objectively and without emotion, does it work for the shareholders? Is it accretive in value or is it not? Yeah. And if it's not, it won't be done. If it is, it will be done.
Could you expand a little bit more, though, maybe about why the deal would be so important to Woolworths?
I don't know, so important. I don't think it's at a figure it's desirable to do because those assets are complementary to the assets that we have got. We've got the ability to be able to manage those hotels, and of course we have got significant volume in the liquor business, and we can get economies of scale, and so putting those assets together, they've got value to us.
Now, Roger, I guess on days like this you really know what it's like to be a CEO. Are you enjoying this far? Did you wake up today and feel it was one of the best days of your life or one of the worst?
Well, no, I didn't have any feeling. I always, walk down the garage and get in the car and drive off to work, battle the traffic along Military Road, and toot the horn and all that stuff and get to work. I feel very innovative and ready to go and look forward to the challenge and look forward to things where I can make a bit of a difference and type of burrow in there. I love type of management. I don't like to be in too much of a routine. I don't like to, have everything tied up. And of course, I've got a wonderful secretary and lots of people that, if you're not careful, you get so programmed, you find you actually don't make a difference. One of the really good things is to be able to roam around, as it were, in the business at freely. and to be able to identify things, pounce on things, if you like, where you can type a stir it up and get a different horizon and change the pattern and change the tempo. That's why I love being a CEO. You have more freedom to move and no one type of looking over your shoulder, so.
I guess many people in this room might have read reports of your incredible attention to detail, and I was rereading one the other day about you finding a supermarket trolley down at Circular Quay, I think, on a Sunday or a Saturday, and pushing it back to the town hall store. Is that could that be true?
Well, I was walking along. I had a briefcase in my hand, and I was down near the quay, down near George Street, and this guy went by with one of our trolleys. And I said to myself, that's one of my trolleys, one of our trolleys. And then I got on a bit further and I thought, $157.95 before GST. And I thought, play that, I'm going to go back and get that. So I type of jogged back and he was walking at a fair pace. So I put one hand on the trolley and said, excuse me, sir, I'm from Woolies and this is one of our trolleys. Do you mind if I take it back? And I think we had a language difficulty because he kept going. So I put my briefcase in the trolley and put both hands on the trolley and Tiber gave it a quick wrench to the right. You didn't teach me how to do this, by the way. And I got it. And he then type of... And I got the trolley between me and him. Long ways. And he went away finally, but there was a couple of seconds there where I was asking myself, is this worth it? But... But I was soon to answer the question, because having retrieved the trolley, our, of course, only store, as you know, is in the corner of Park and George Street, and it was a long way to walk with the trolley.
Okay, so we know...
But I delighted to do it, by yes. the way. Yeah. I delighted to do it because it communicated a message. That's why I did it, to everyone in the store, that a trolley's a trolley. And $157, $157. And if it takes walking the lengths of George Street to save it, well, then we walk the lengths of George Street to save it. And here's a trolley, and I bought it back. Now, the only problem was they don't have any trolleys in that store. So
okay, well, that's the kind of passion for retail.
But that was their problem, not mine.
That's the kind of passion for retail that I think we need to delve right back into your childhood now and discover where all this passion for retail came from. So would you tell us a little bit about growing up? What are the lessons maybe from your own early years before you managed to get into the retailing industry? What were you focused on?
Well, I grew up in Mossman, one of three boys. Younger brother Richard is also a graduate from this university, and my brother Peter. We grew up in a very happy family. My father grew up in the Depression in really difficult times and contracted TB and spent a year overcoming it. So he had a really tough upbringing and had absolutely nothing. And he and his brothers started a chemical business, buying the salt from the tanneries, and his two brothers were chemical engineers, and they type of purified the salt by methods that didn't actually seem to me you needed a chemical engineering degree to do, but anyway, they did, and they started a manufacturing company, which was developed into the second largest chemical manufacturing company in Australia. And so our early years were very prosperous. And I went to shore. But our subsequent years weren't nearly as prosperous because my father sold his share of the business and invested it elsewhere. And what he'd spent the first 25 years of his life earning, he lost most of it, sadly, in the latter part of his life. And things were quite tough. And I can remember even going to school where it was tough to buy a pair of shoes for me. Now, when you are at a school where everyone else is like that, it's not, I think, as bad as where you're at a school where no one else is like that. Or it seemed to me That had an immense effect upon me personally. And there were some difficult times. And so that, I think, created a drive and a determination that no matter what, no matter what handicaps, whatever it was, I was going to make it through, and whatever it took. I think that was a very fortunate thing that actually happened to me. And I think people that grow up never having known the value of a quid, or not having it, or the pressure of real need, grow up with a dimension of life that makes it much harder to have that hunger and drive and determination.
So did you go straight to a university from school, or
I did. As a matter of fact, I well remember, you know, like a lot of guys who left school, I didn't know quite what I was going to do. And I remember this course, commerce, came up, and I liked business because, as I said, my family had been in business. But there was a course called statistical methods that I actually didn't like the sound of. And I remember being on the beach at Maroomba with a fellow called Cole Freestone that also did commerce subsequently. And I said, you know, Cole, what about this statistical methods? Oh, he said, mate, he said, don't worry about it. It's only a few averages, that type of thing. And I can remember thinking about that when Professor Roger Layton was lecturing us. It didn't seem like a few averages to me.
Indeed. And did you...
So I selected commerce and came here. And, of course, commerce was in its very early stages. We were across the other side of the road, and lectures were in KCOM 100 and KCOM 200. And it was still then very much the sand plains out here. But there's a great spirit in commerce, and I think that foundation that was laid and the work that's been done in this university has made commerce, of course, the preeminent basic degree course in Australia, and I think this university can be greatly proud of it.
And why did you go into retailing? What was the lure of retailing?
Well, I actually got into my first year here, and I acquired my first car, which is a Morris Minor, four-door, little window at the back, some people remember, headlights on the top of the mudguard. When I bought it, it seemed to make a lot of black smoke, and I said to the fellow, does this burn oil? And he assured me in the most vigorous of terms it didn't. Well, as it turned out, going across the hump on the Harbour Bridge coming out here, I had to change into second gear to get over the hump, and in fact very often the traffic behind was completely obliterated with black smoke. And this car broke down. And my father explained to me that some source of income would be a really smart thing to do if I want to continue to drive it. So I thought to myself, well, I just won't go for a casual job. I'll write to a whole lot of companies and explain to them that I'm lucky enough to do commerce, and when I graduate, I'll be a fantastic employee, and if they'd care to give me a job during my university course, well, then I'll not only be skilled from this great university, but I'll have experience in their business. And I wrote a dozen of these letters, and I got one reply. And that was from Grace Brothers. And so I accepted that reply, and I've got to tell you, that's how I got into retailing.
Indeed, great. Now,
when they asked me, by the way, at the interview, why did you choose Grace Brothers, it was a pretty hard question to answer.
Indeed. Now, your sort of passion for retail obviously grew over the years, and it's well known. I just wanted to talk a little bit about your interest in Walmart and what you've learnt from the American retail chain, because you obviously have, over many years, had a great affection for that chain. You've had a close relationship with Jack Shoemaker. And so I wondered if you'd talk a little bit about why. Why Walmart? Why so interesting?
Well, it seems hard to believe. David Jones has done very well, by the way, but it seems hard to believe that David Jones bought Woolworths. But David Jones did buy Woolworths. What happened in 1987 is the profit of Woolworths collapsed. And whenever that happens, it does do bad things to your share price. And Woolworths was acquired by IEL, for about $680 million. And John Spalvins was then one of the predators of that time. And he decided, it was the last thing he did and was actually probably the thing that brought him down, because he did it with borrowed funds and the people wanted the funds back, which is always inconvenient. And he bought Woolworths for $863 million. And it had a division called Big W that had been in existence for 20 years and had just lost $40 million on a turnover of $400 million and had never made a profit. And I had a nice secure job as Director of Operations in David Jones, and John Spalvins asked me if I'd go and take over Big W. And I went and looked at some of the stores, and they were terrible. I'd actually never seen anything like it. And I can remember walking out of Jesmond in Newcastle. It was a Saturday, and my wife, Rosemary, was with me. And I would said to her, point out all the terrible things. And as I walked out the door of Jesmond's store, I said, I'm not taking this job. This place is dead. You can actually feel the decay. It wouldn't work. And we walked out in silence, and I opened the door for her to get in, and she sat in the car, and she looked over the rim of the door at me, and she said, I'll never forget this, and I'll ever be grateful to her. I love her dearly. She said, give it a go. You'll never forgive yourself if you don't. And without those words, I can tell you, I wouldn't have given it a go. And I walked around the car, opened the door, sat in, and said, we'll give it a go. And I then met Paul Simons, and he said, we've got a consultant done a bit of work for us called Shoemaker. He said, he's a big, tall fella, and he works for a company called Walmart. Have you heard of Walmart? I said, yeah, I think I have. Yeah. I said, they've done something on scanning, haven't they? I felt particularly well-informed. And he said, do you know where the headquarters is? He said, do you know where Arkansas is? And I said, well, I think it's actually towards the middle, isn't it, somewhere? He said, yeah, that's right. He said, have you ever been to Bentonville? And I said, no. He said, well, he said, I'd like you to go to Bentonville and meet Jack Shoemaker and see if you want to continue his consultancy and if he can be any help to you. And so I flew to Los Angeles. And then I flew to Dallas. And then I took a little plane from Dallas to a place called Fayetteville. And then I hired a car and I drove for an hour until I got to a place called Springdale, where I stayed in the local motel because there was no motel in Bentonville. And when I finally made it to Bentonville the next day, it reminded me of Picton. It looked a bit like that. And in fact, I went to Jack Shoemaker's christening of his kid in the First Presbyterian Church in Bentonville. I don't know why it was the first, because there's certainly not room for a second. But during the service, I met a really nice lady called Helen, and she and Sam had been to Australia. And we got chatting, and Sam was very busy and had to go back to America. I don't know who Sam was at this stage. Anyway, at lunchtime, we went to Fred's Hickory Inn for lunch, and it was the only restaurant in town. It was type of logs. And during lunch, Sam arrived, driving a car that looked to me like a Ford Falcon. Pretty dirty. And he came in, sat down, and Jack Shoemaker got him, brought him over to him. And said, he said, well, right, nice to meet you, Roger. He said, why don't you come and see me, visit me tomorrow? He said, I'll be in my office from 4 a.m. onwards. You'll be welcome any time from then on. So that started the relationship. And as I walked around the Walmart stores and saw this immensely important culture, the culture is unbelievable. And businesses getting the right culture and the sense of belonging and commitment and vitality, it was just absolutely inspiring. And when I came back to Australia and joined the management team at Big W, they were all pretty experienced retailers. And they were type of analysing what Walmart could give them. And they were type of saying, look, I think Walmart had got it wrong there, and I think we should modify this here, and I think we'll only take part of that. And I said, look, why don't we just copy them exactly? Because they seem to be a tad ahead of us. And I'll tell you what, in life, the next thing after having a good idea yourself is to pick someone else who's got a good idea. And then copy it absolutely. And I've got to tell you, that's exactly what I've done, and it's worked a treat.
Excellent, which might be a good point to ask a little more around retailing. I mean, are we in a situation in Australia with a relatively small market where we're almost at saturation point? I mean, clearly this is one of the reasons why you want to move into liquor. Where do you see the future of retailing going in Australia, given the sort of constraints of both distance, I suppose, and a relatively small market?
Well, if you could give me a piece of paper and say to me, would you divide the market up in type of an optimum way for you? And if Mr. Samuels gave me permission to do that, hard to imagine, but let's try. I couldn't break it up any better than it is at the present time. Because Woolies got 28.5% of the market, Coles Myer got 22-23%, and 50% of the market is spread across small operators in Australia. So it gives excellent opportunity for growth. The small part of the market is 50%, and by European or American standards, that is very high, by the way. Sainsbury's, Asda, and Tesco and Britain have got much higher market shares than that in many of the concentrated markets of Europe, as has Carrefour or as have major operators in America. So Woolworths and Coles' share of the Australian market is relatively low. There is excellent opportunity to expand, but at the same time, there is, of course, the opportunity to have economies of scale. So both Woolworths and Coles deliver to the Australian people a really good offering by world standards in terms of the range and presentation of supermarkets, but the operating costs that they deliver. And they, of course, operate on about 3.5% to 4% EBIT margins, which are the lowest in the world, and so a very efficient service is delivered. So it's a finely balanced market, it's an excellently balanced market, and all this misinformation that is fed to the market that Woolworths and Coles dominate the market and the independents are battling to survive is just rubbish. The independents of Australia are doing very well. Metcash and FAL in their wholesale divisions have got very, very buoyant businesses. So it's a very buoyant independent market and it's a very competitive one. And I think the Australian people are well served. In terms of expansion, I can see Woolworths continue to expand in its format for many years to come. And there are opportunities, of course, to ratchet our intellectual property. And when we've completed this stage of Project Refresh, we will have intellectual property which will be equal to anything in the world, equal to Tesco and equal to Walmart. And I think that does give us a leverage opportunity for the future. Hope Mr. Fletcher doesn't copy that one.
Can you tell us just briefly anything about Project Mercury, which is again, something that's been kept under wraps, this project, which is really a supply chain management project as we understand it. Is it sort of the end of the warehouse? That's what it's almost been suggested that it will lead to.
No, it's the beginning of the warehouse. In fact, many of the, and we are spending, I hope it's not the end of the warehouse, by the way, because we're spending $800 million building them, so it'll be a bad mistake if it is. No, it's going to change the whole distribution, and we will see a lot more cross-docking, we'll see a lot more flow-through, we'll see electronic link between our cash register and Terry Davis's team. They will have complete transparency of what's happening in the marketplace. That will bring enormous economies to them and to us in delivering a product to our customers at a much cheaper cost. And Project Mercury, Project Refresh is the building of the facilities. But Project Mercury is a really terribly interesting part of the process. We'd have several hundred people working on it, and it is just to do with the change process and managing an organisation as big as ours, changing the habits, changing the way people do things, changing the way people think, because it's no good spending money on facilities and technology if you don't change how it's done. And in a major business, actually getting change is the most challenging aspect. And we'd be happy, by the way, Professor, to have some of your students sit in, your undergraduates sit in on that process at any stage. And I think today I chaired the Project Mercury Steering Committee, and it consisted of my senior colleagues sitting with me in a room, and then about, I suppose, 40 of our younger executives that are all involved in various parts, and they listen to the debate and hear the discussion about how the decisions are made, and that inclusive way of being able to develop change and decision-making processes through the organisation is one of the most exciting things I think I'm involved in.
Excellent. Just talking about students and younger people, what do you look for in people that you're hiring? What sort of advice would you give to this room of many aspirational people here about what they need to do to get on?
Well, first of all, a person needs the skills to do the job. But those skills don't need to be absolutely enormously developed all at necessarily the top level. But what they do need to do is they need to have two things. They need to be hungry and have drive and determination. And secondly, they need to have a commitment and an integrity to commit themselves to a team and be able not always to ask what the team's going to do for me, but to have an attitude of what I can do for the team. And if you can get those things balanced together, but a determination, a vitality, and a preparedness to be focused and do whatever it takes to do the job, they're the things I look for.
Great. Now, I think we might actually open for questions, because on past experience there are a lot of questions. There are roving mics, so if you make yourself known, there's a question just down here, I think. Did you have a hand up? No? Yeah, there is one just there, just here.
Simon Kelly's my name. I'm an engineer. I'm a big fan of systems. If you have a recurring problem in your business, you don't just ignore it. You try and develop a system that will eliminate the problem now and stop it recurring. One thing that fascinates me about retail and supermarkets is shopping trolleys. You turn up, you grab the first one, it's crap. So what do? You put it back and you grab the next one, and you eventually find one which is good. There's no mechanism in place for you to be able to take the crap one to little crap trolley bay and leave it there so that other customers don't have to use it. Now, from your perspective, you don't want every customer walking in the store grumpy and unhappy that it took them three goes to get the right trolley. So it's in your interest to develop a mechanism to make it happen. I'm just surprised after... I've lived in the same suburb for 32 years. They don't even... know or care. You talk to management there and it's whatever, go away. It just amazes me that there's not some sort of system you can develop and roll it out across the country and thrill your clients. Have you thought about it?
Yes, I have. But you've got a very good thought and I appreciate it, and I'll give your thought some consideration. Thank you very much.
Right. Next one. Just here. Thank you.
Good evening, Mr. Corbett. I'm a tax practitioner operating on the North Shore in your area of Mossman, or just down from there. Less salubrious area, Brookvale. My question to you is just simply this. What don't you see Woolworths retailing?
Thank you. I don't see it retailing high-margin, low-volume items. So you won't see us in department stores. You won't see us in product that is as I said, it's a different mindset. So we're in fashion, but we're in volume selling fashion. You won't see us at the cutting edge of fashion. So if you like, the definition is, in terms of merchandise, low margin, high volume merchandise where we can leverage a better deal for our customers, and our competitive advantage comes in the efficiencies we can bring to the distribution chain.
Thank you.
Good, just here.
What opportunities do you see Woolies can expand overseas, and what countries do you think may be able to use some of Woolies' intellectual property, for example, the warehouse thing that you were developing?
Well, I think one of the really exciting things that is happening in our part of the world is the enormous growth of China, and I think soon to be followed by India, and the type of knowledge and the education is just, I think, one of the most exciting things I've seen. And I can't believe, in my short lifetime, to see the change, for instance, you go to a city like Shanghai, what it was like when I first went there in the late 50s and 60s, and what it's like today. So clearly, those economies of Asia that are developing are an enormous driver for our own prosperity in Australia. I'm sure you understand that better than I. These countries are actually not short of capital or of ability. But what makes... You see that major retailers have an enormous trouble when they go into other cultures. When you go into a Walmart store in Bentonville, normally an older person or woman greets you at the door. And they're all done up and they say, "Heidi, have a trolley!" And it goes, by the way. and they type of got this friendly thing. But when they move to Germany and they try to use the same culture, German people don't actually in that culture greet each other. So when someone says, "Hey," terrible shock. They smiled and said, "Have a nice day." And that's what they do in Bentonville. It goes over real well. But in Germany, it doesn't go over so well. So what retailers have is a great problem, and Australian retailers have had it as well, is exporting their concept of retailing into another market and another culture, and deciding what becomes a defining characteristic that makes a Walmart in Bentonville, and what is a Walmart in China or Thailand or Korea. But if it's possible to export your intellectual property, the know-how of how you do it, to a partner who runs a business, say it was in India, in an Indian way of doing it, I think that is an opportunity. And it's a much lower risk opportunity. It's an opportunity to leverage your capital. Now, that's a possibility. I just mentioned it only as a possibility.
Have you ever wondered how Australians would react to that greeting at the door?
Well, we try to do a bit of it, but it works in some places, yes.
Great.
You've got to have the right person.
Yes, sure. Now, just down here a couple of people. There's a two down here, I think.
I'm an academic at the university in the marketing area. Actually, I didn't teach the course that you had such fun with, that Roger Layton taught. But anyway, the supply chain area that you mentioned, does that presumably involve some renegotiation of the relationships you have with some of your suppliers?
It does.
And I'm wondering to what extent you're involved with that. And do you know, for example, the CEOs of your major suppliers? And how important has that been in your strategy?
Well, it is enormously important because what is happening is the whole format of marketing is changing. Because in the food industry, what used to happen is everyone had the same shelf prices and nothing in a breach of the Trade Practice Act or anything like that, but There used to be general agreement that Franklin's had sit at a particular location and Coles had Bi-Lo sitting at a lower level, so Bi-Lo was going to compete with Franklin's and Coles supermarkets were going to compete with Woolies, and the market was type of stratified. And in fact, years ago, before the present Trade Practices Act, let me say, but there was always, you know, Billy Smith has got the prices down a bit, let's get the prices up, the margin's not quite right. So there used to be a lot of margin management going on. And if a particular product's margin wasn't too good, they'd be punished. They'd be put on the lower shelf until they type of marketed the product so it got in the right thing. And so everything was a type of status quo. And then the manufacturers used to mount the promotion. So along come Kellogg's and they say, boy, have we got a deal for you. You know, with every pallet, you get 5 3 cartons, you get a this and that and a something else here and a twist there, all dreamed up by the marketing department, by the way. And so then if you can advertise it at a particular time, and we suggest a price in the range of, and of course no one else will have this product when you're advertising it, so you'll type of have an exclusive on it at that price, and then you'd buy 10 times more than you wanted for the promotion. This is the food industry in Australia. So that was called opportunity buys. And that was stored in a big warehouse. Now, Mr. Kellogg's needed a big warehouse to stockpile this manufactured goods before he sold it to you. So then you had a big warehouse. So you have the promotion, and then the price would revert back to the original price, but of course you had all this stock that you bought at the better price. And across the industry, that was worth 3%. It's called opportunity buys. So when Mr. Kellogg's had finished doing a deal with you, he'd duck around the corner, he'd do a deal with Coles. When he finished doing the deal with Coles, he'd pop around and see Franklin's. When he finished with Franklin's, he'd pop around and see with them was David's. Do a deal. And then, of course, you'd use up your Kellogg's by that stage, so he's back to do another deal with you. Now, it sounds pretty silly, doesn't it? The cost of the supply chain was immense. But, of course, what the manufacturers were doing was actually controlling the game. And they kept the market nicely in balance. These guys down here know what I'm saying. And but it was most inefficient. So what's happened is those games have all gone. And there's now competition across the marketplace. And so you've seen a couple of things happen. As efficiencies in retailing in Australia have grown, you've seen the prices come down. And we've taken about $2.5 billion out of our costs in the last 4.5 years. And $2 billion of that have gone back to the customers in price reductions. So the Walmart model, which I've just told you I'm a great believer in, is to drive the business's greatest efficiency possible and offer to your customers the best shelf prices and get a continuity of flow. So everyday low prices or consistent pricing has nothing to do with marketing. It has everything to do with getting the maximum efficiency from your distribution model. Because an automated distribution, the logarithms that go in it can never manage a distribution line that goes like that. It's got to be a distribution line that goes like that. And the immense costs in that, both in the production and a transport and a storage area, not to mention the outer stocks, is gigantic. So Australia is very much still a promotionally driven market, but it will move inevitably to the model that I've said or described. Woolworths are doing it, Coles are now doing it also, and that model doesn't work. So inevitably it come back. Now the process of change is immensely difficult because the marketing department guy or the transport guy sees his job is vested in the present structure. And if all of a sudden Woolworths want to buy net and don't want you to do the marketing for them, thanks very much, we'll spend our money when we want to do it. Well then the marketing fella says, hey, what's my future? So how you negotiate these changes and how effective the integration between the supply base and the retailer is going to be in the future is going to be one of the major revolutions that we see in that marketing space in Australia. And it's going to be fascinating. And how effectively the supply base and the retailers negotiate that is going to be immensely important. And the success of the retailers and their supply base will be determined on how well they do it.
Another question just here.
Mr. Corbett. The retail industry, and in particular the supermarkets in Australia, collect an incredible amount of information regarding the spending patterns of Australians. And it just seems that a lot of that information is completely underutilised. And I was just wondering what plans Woolworths have to start using that information further and to the better of the company.
Well, we endeavour to collect as much product information as we can, but the information base is actually changing right now very significantly because retailers haven't had retail inventory in their stores. So they've really only known the information in bulk. We haven't known what's in a typical basket. But now we've got retail inventory, and that's part of the supply chain. It's enormous cost. We can follow the sales of individual items a lot more closely. But we are really running chains, and the economies are having a uniformity in those chains. So a concept of having range differentials in each store and marketing to each individual customer in different ways is probably never going to have great mileage because the cost of doing so is out of step with the format. And even the cost of having different ranges in different stores is immensely expensive to do. And you need lots of administrative people to do it, even with technology. We've got in our Big W division a store in Mount Gravatt in Queensland, which is much bigger than the rest. And the idea is that it should have a bigger range. But unless you invest very heavily in your central support operation to service that different range, it very quickly becomes uniform because the buyer can only do so much. And the margins that we make out of the economies that we drive does not leave an enormous amount of money for type of focused marketing. So you can collect the information, but the question is really how are you going to use it? And that's the quandary.
Good. Another question here.
Yeah. Mr. Corbett, Justin Williams. I'm aware that there's a growing concern in the US over security and trade and commerce, and the Transport Security Administration is running a number of pilots over there to try and understand the best ways that they can mitigate some of the risks associated with terrorism. I'm interested to hear your views on the security focus on trade and commerce here in Australia and the likely implications that may have for additional costs for you in dealing with your supply chain.
Well, of course, as we all know, very fortunately, we've had no major incident in Australia. And may God preserve us that continues to occur. We have security information. We endeavour to respond to particular situations that occur from time to time. But, of course, any public place, whether it's a train or a shopping centre, is vulnerable. If ever there was a terrorist attack, then it would have a terrible effect, I think, upon the our psychological balance in Australia, and the cost would be horrific. But the truth of the matter is that at the end of the day, that it's not possible to protect large groups of people where they congregate absolutely anywhere, except if you have the type of security that involved in airlines, which of course would be prohibitive. So thank you for your question. And I suppose it's all our absolute hope that nothing of that nature ever happens to our country.
I think time for another two questions. There's a gentleman here who has his hand up very high, and then we'll take that one down the back as well. This gentleman here, yeah.
Robert Bozak, EL Consult, Roger. In the Australian market, your major competitor has gone down a very different path to yourself, and that has been to go into generics and house brands. And you've also seen the launch and establishment of the German group Aldi into the Australian market. Woolworths has remained very passive on the sort of generics. You've maintained a focus on suppliers that are branded. What's the reasoning behind that, and do you see Woolworths changing that sort of product mix in your product offering going forward?
Thank you for a very interesting question. I don't think we actually are passive. Our home brand is, as you know, the biggest brand in the Australian marketplace, in a generic sense. Our volume is bigger than any other brand. Now, why generics have failed or haven't got a big hold in the markets around the world is because the retailers have been too greedy. And what they've done is wanting to maximise the margin they could get out of the generics. They've specified the item down and taken maximum price. So you get a generic baked beans and you're flat out finding the bean. So, you know, you think you've been done, and the truth is you have been done. So what we have done, Woolies, is we have been prepared in our generics to take a lower margin and deliberately build the quality of that product up, and to build it up as high as we possibly can do, and to deliver a price and to use our leverage, our volume of those items, and put a significant portion of it into a superior quality. We test this all the time, and our home brand is equal to or better than anything else in the marketplace. Now, that's been our policy. But it's interesting, you know, as good as generics can be, mum's happy to have a couple in a shopping trolley, but she doesn't want to go out with the shopping trolley full of generics. It just looks as though things are a bit down on the upper. So when I walk around our stores, I love to say to the customers, smart buying, ma'am. You're onto a good one there. And do a little bit of reinsuring if I can. So our generics is growing. I also think, you know, it's quite interesting why I think Aldi are finding the Australian marketplace harder than they might have thought. Because we're making sure that our home brand and its price, there's nothing in an Aldi store that is better. Now, what we were doing with branded merchandise was delivering national brands, because the strategy was that in delivering consistent and everyday prices, cottage jam is a cottage jam, whether it's on our shelf or our competitor's shelf. And if we can deliver that as a better price, then immediately customers can make a comparison, because they know it's the same. But if it's some generic brand or home brand, they think you've engineered it to a price. But we've recently decided to change that. And we are going to carry a Woolworths brand across our stores in categories where it's appropriate. It's not appropriate in water, because water's water, and maybe hand towels are hand towels. But where a product can have a specification that is clearly a demonstrative quality item, we will put Woolworths brand name only on a premium quality item, equal in that category to the best, plus a margin, and we intend to sell it at between 10 and 20% below the market price for the leader in that marketplace. Why have we done that? We've done that because the branded merchants will not give us any reward for being branded only, national branded only, and the margin is such that I can't forfeit the opportunity vis-a-vis our competitor. So I have changed.
Now, final question.
Can I just say one other thing on this? This is terribly interesting, you know. Marks and Spencer had a world-leading business. They delivered a product, a branded product, St Michael's was mainly their branded name, into the market at a superior quality, at a slightly higher price. So they asked for a premium for a product that was significantly better. And it was an enormous formula. And Marks and Spencer was process driven. They knew more about acquiring raw materials, more about how they were to be manufactured, more about the specifications, more about the packaging than their supply base did. And they delivered that model for years. But the great danger of this is you begin to believe your own propaganda. And what happened in the British market was that people delivered the same quality as Marks and Spencer, but at a better price. And Marks and Spencer's enormous asset of having this product differential that all the market knew. But unfortunately, when all the market knew that the differential was no longer there, the last people to really realise it was Marks and Spencer themselves. And you know, it's funny, businesses begin to believe their own ethos. And not so long ago, I got a complaint from a customer who said she'd been purchasers of our home brand frozen carrots for many years. And recently, the quality had collapsed. And she used to use them for her vegetable soup. And no longer were these carrots up to scratch. So I sent the letter to the buying group and I said, have a look at this. But I said, don't reply to the customer before you let me know. So I put on the bring up file and 3 days later I rang up and said, what about that letter to the customer? Oh, they said, don't worry. They said, we've drafted a letter. We're just about to send the letter to the customer. I said, but I asked you to... Oh, they said, so sorry about that. Did you really mean that? I said, yes, I did. Would you send me your draft letter? And the draft letter started off, Dear Mrs. Brown, we've received your letter about our carrots. We find this hard to believe because we've sold 25 million packets of this and yours is the first complaint we've ever had. However, please find a complimentary lot of carrots for you. Thank you very much.